Hello everyone, myself Dr. M. Srijan Kumar. My education background is pharmacy. Today's topic is WHO guideline for assessment of herbal drugs. So WHO has framed some guidelines in order to ensure quality, safety and efficacy of herbal drugs. So let us go on to the topic now. Coming to the introduction, plant materials are used throughout developed and developing countries as home remedies, over-the-counter drug products and raw materials for the pharmaceutical industry and represent a substantial proportion of the global drug market. Nowadays, you can see these plant materials have been used throughout developed countries as well as upcoming developing countries. Okay, these plant materials are used as home remedies. They are also used as over-the-counter drug products. They are used as herbal supplements. They are used as raw materials in pharmaceutical industry. So if you can check with the global market, they are adding a substantial proportion for the global market. It is therefore essential to establish internationally recognized guidelines for assessing their quality. So as these particular plant materials have been used in all the areas, okay, throughout the global drug market, so it is important to ensure quality for that plant materials. The World Health Assembly in one resolution it has emphasized the need to ensure the quality of medicinal plant products by using modern control techniques and applying suitable standards. So the World Health Assembly, okay, it has passed a resolution, and in that resolution they have emphasized that in order to ensure the quality of medicinal plant products, okay, they have adopted some modern control techniques and they have adopted some suitable standards also. So by this modern control technique and suitable standards, okay, they have planned to ensure the quality of medicinal products. These guidelines describes a series of tests for assessing the quality of medicinal plant materials. So what way this guideline will help us? This particular guideline, it will describe some series of tests, okay, in order to assess the quality of a plant material. What we need to do, we need to evaluate the plant material. So in order to evaluate the plant material, we need to have what, some test procedures are required. So that test procedures are included in this guideline. The tests are designed primarily for use in national drug quality control laboratories. First, these tests have been introduced and at a preliminary level in national drug control laboratories in some developing countries and complement those described in the international pharmacopoeia. Okay, and these particular methods are also included in your international. The analysis of medicinal plant material is not restricted to those methods discussed or recommended here, and many techniques similar to those used for the analysis of synthetic drugs are also frequently employed. Example, volumetric analysis, gravimetric determinations, gas chromatography, column chromatography, high performance liquid chromatography and spectrophotometric method. So whatever methods we are going to discuss under this WHO guidelines for assessment of herbal materials, okay, it is not that you need to stick to the particular methods which are discussed here. You can also adopt some other methods which are used for analysis of your synthetic drugs, which are frequently employed, like volumetric analysis, gravimetric analysis, spectrophotometric methods and all. When considering the choice of method, the level of detection and herbal material matrix used for the testing, like seeds containing oils, must be taken into account and the method modified if required. So any choice of method selected for testing any kind of content in your herbal material, okay, it might be seeds containing oils or anything to be detected, the level of detection and the herbal material matrix used for the testing is important. Okay, in some instances when you are not able to detect the content in herbal material, you can also modify the method if required. The method of determination should be validated for the relevant matrix. Okay, if you modify the method should be validated accordingly. That's all about your introduction of your WHO guidelines. Now coming to the assessment of herbal materials, the first one is powder fineness and seed size. In this section, you are going to study about what are the different sizes of powders available and what are the different mesh sizes of the seeds available. Okay, next, general advice on sampling. It is very important. Any herbal material that has been given to test for the quality, sampling procedures are very important. That we are going to see under this section. Okay, how the sampling will be done and how the samples will be carried out for the testing. Next one is determination of foreign matter. It is a common kind of a thing that any herbal material will contain some kind of foreign matter. How to determine that foreign matter, we are going to discuss under this section. Next, macroscopic and microscopic examination, followed by thin layer chromatography, followed by determination of ash content, then determination of extractable matter, then determination of water and volatile matter, then determination of volatile oils, then determination of bitterness value, determination of hemolytic activity, determination of tannins, determination of swelling index, determination of foaming index, determination of pesticide residues, determination of arsenic and toxic materials, determination of microorganisms, determination of alpha toxins, determination of radioactive contamination, culture media and stains used for microbiological analysis. These are the list of assessments to be done for your herbal materials. Coming to the first one, powder fineness and sieve size. So coming to the first section, powder, the coarseness or fineness of a powder is classified according to the nominal aperture size expressed in micrometers of the mesh of the sieve through which the powder will pass, and it is indicated as shown in table. So any powder that has been obtained from herbal extracts, that particular powder should be assessed whether that powder belongs to a coarse category, moderately coarse category, moderately fine, fine or very fine. That can be assessed based upon the sieve size and it can be expressed in micrometers. Now coarse, for coarse, the sieve size is 2000 by 355, the mesh size is 2000 by 355. All the particles will pass through a sieve number 2000 and not more than 40% through 355 sieve. For moderately coarse, 710 by 250, all the particle will pass through a 710 sieve, not more than 40% through 250. Moderately fine, when we can call that powder is a moderately fine, all the particle pass through sieve number 355 and not more than 40% through 180. When we are going to call that powder as fine powder, all the particles passing through sieve number 180, then you can say that the particles are fine. When you are going to say that the powder particles are very fine, all the particles passing through sieve number 125. Okay, so this is the classification of your powder sizes according to their respective sieve numbers. Next, sieves. Coming to the sieve, the wide sieves used to sift powder herbal materials are classified by number that indicate their nominal aperture size expressed in micrometers. Whatever number we have indicated under powder, like 2000 or 355, that represents your nominal aperture size and it is expressed in micrometers. The sieves are made up of wire of uniform circular cross section and have the specification indicated in table. Now we are going to see the specifications. Yeah, coming to the specifications. So number of the sieve, nominal size of the aperture, nominal diameter of wire and approximate screening area. All these are nothing but specifications for your sieve. Okay. So if, for example, if you take the sieve number as 2000, what would be the nominal aperture size? It is 2 mm. Nominal diameter of wire 0.90 mm. And approximate screening area is 48%. This is how it is the information given for all the types of sieve numbers. Okay. Coming to the next section of your assessment, general advice on sampling. General advice on sampling. The reliability of any conclusion drawn from the analysis of a sample will depend upon how well the sample represents the whole batch. For example, it is not that you take the samples which are in good condition, but the sampling will determine your whole batch. In what way? Because herbal material, it will not be prepared in 1 kg or 500 grams or 250 grams. It will be prepared in big lots. When you say big lots, it will be prepared in tons. So when it is prepared in tons, sampling will be done randomly. Okay. So that sampling should give a conclusion for reliability of your herbal material. Okay. That reliability will ensure the quality for the whole batch. Because of the specific characteristics of herbal materials, in particular their lack of homogeneity, special handling procedures are required in relation to sampling. Okay, as we know that herbal materials are having specific characteristics. Okay, in particular what they lack is they lack homogeneity. So as they lack homogeneity, so the special handling procedures are required in relation to sampling. How you are going to handle the sample, it is very important, because we know that as herbal materials hold some special characteristics, they lack what? Homogeneity. Okay. The following procedure should be observed when selecting and preparing an average sample from a batch of material. So what are the following procedures to be followed, that we are going to see under next slide. The first procedure is sampling of material in bulk. Check the condition of the package and note any defects that may influence the quality or stability of the contents, like physical damage, moisture, etc. Sample damage container individually. Okay. As soon as you get the sample, the prime importance should be given for checking the condition of the package and observe for defects which may influence the quality and stability of the contents. So observing the defects like physical damage, are there any physical damage on the package? Okay, is there any moisture present on the package? Okay, apart from that, you need to check sample damage containers individually. So how the sampling should be done and how the sample should be taken from a batch. Okay, there are three steps here. The first step is that if you got a sample batch of 5 containers or packaging units, so you need to take one from each. Okay, if you have got a batch of 6 to 50 units, you need to take sample from 5. If you have got a batch over 50 units, so you need to take sample of 10%, rounding up the number of units to the nearest multiple of 10. Okay, when a batch is over 50 units, you need to take sample of 10%, rounding up the number of units to the nearest multiple of 10. After opening, inspect the contents of the units selected for sampling. Okay, immediately after the opening, you need to inspect the contents of the unit. What you need to inspect for? First, you need to inspect for organoleptic characteristics like color, texture, and odor. Followed by presentation of the material. You need to see the presentation of the material, whether it is a raw one or it is a cut one, it is a crushed one, or it is a compressed one. Okay, so you need to see the presentation of the material. Next, followed by the presence of admixtures, foreign matter. You need to check for the presence of admixtures, foreign matter, like sand, glass particles, dirt, mold, or signs of decay. This should be checked. And the next, presence of insects. You need to be checked for presence of insects. Next, the presence of packaging material originating from poor or degraded containers. Next, you need to check for presence of packaging material originating from poor or degraded containers. These 5 things to be checked immediately after opening the container. Okay. So the first thing, you are going to select the samples. Okay. After selecting the samples, that samples to be inspected before going for further test. Okay. That inspection should be done for following like organoleptic characteristics, presentation of the materials, presence of admixtures, foreign matters, presence of insects, presence of packaging material originating from poor or degraded containers. Next, the final samples are tested for the following characteristics. After inspecting, you will be going for testing your final samples for the following characteristics. What are the characteristics? Degree of fragmentation. Degree of fragmentation, nothing but sieve test to check the coarseness, fineness of your particles. Identity and level of impurities. Identity and level of impurities. Moisture and ash content. Moisture and ash content. Level of active ingredient where possible. Level of active ingredient where possible. A portion of each final sample should be retained to serve as reference materials, which may also be used for retest purposes if necessary. After completion of the testing, okay, a portion of the final sample should be retained as a reference sample. Okay, in future you may again, there is a chance for retesting of your sample. Okay, in that conditions you need to have what? Reference sample. Yeah, next procedure under sampling is sampling of material in retail packages. Now the procedure is about sampling of material in bulk. Now the next procedure is sampling of material in retail packages. So from each wholesale container, boxes, cartons, etc., selected for sampling, take at random two consumer packages. So whatever wholesale containers you have, like it might be boxes or cartons, from that you need to take random two consumer packages. If you come across small batches like 1 to 5 boxes, take 10 consumer packages. If you come across 1 to 5 boxes, take 10 consumer packages from that. Prepare the pooled sample by mixing the contents of the selected consumer package and proceed as described above to obtain the final sample. So after taking these consumer packages, open the contents of your consumer package, mix it. That opening the 10 consumer packages, so I am giving an example from small batches. Small batches, if you come across 1 to 5 boxes, from 1 to 5 boxes, you are taking 10 consumer packages. That 10 consumer package should be opened, the contents to be poured into a beaker or vessel, okay, and that particular content should be mixed. So after mixing, the container containing the contents are called as pooled sample. Pooling is nothing but collecting and mixing the samples together from each packet. Is nothing but pooling the samples. After pooling the samples, then you need to subject it for final testing. So testing for degree of fragmentation, identity and level of impurities, moisture and ash content, level of active ingredient where possible. Same like you are sampling of material, whatever you have done for bulk. Okay, this is about your advice on sampling. Coming to the next assessment, determination of foreign matter. So first let us know what do you mean by foreign matter. Foreign matter is material consisting of any or all of the following. So part of the herbal material or material other than those named with the limit specified for the herbal material concerned is also called as a foreign matter. Okay, any organism, part or product of an organism other than that named in the specification and description of the herbal material concerned is also a foreign matter. Mineral admixtures not adhering to the herbal material such as soil, stone, sand and dust is also a foreign matter. Okay, anything that is specified, anything that is limited, anything that is named onto the container other than that, anything that is present is called as a foreign matter. So how you are going to take the sample size in order to determine foreign matter? So if you come across samples like roots, rhizomes and bark, 500 grams of sample size to be taken. Roots, rhizomes and bark, 500 grams of sample size to be taken. If you are going with leaves, flowers, seeds and fruits, 250 grams of sample size to be taken. And cut herbal materials, cut herbal materials. Average weight of each fragment less than 0.5 grams, around 50 grams to be taken. Around 50 grams should be taken for cut herbal materials. And these things to be tested for determination of foreign matter. So anything that is not specified on the container or label of that particular herbal material, ultimately that things are nothing but called as foreign matter. Next, macroscopic and microscopic examination. Macroscopic and microscopic examination. So what do you mean by macroscopic examination? Macroscopic identity of herbal material is based on shape, size, color, surface characteristics, texture, fracture characteristics, and appearance of the cut surface, order, and some cases taste if it is given for the herbal material. So what do you mean by macroscopic identity? Macroscopic identity is nothing but some kind of visual observation. So on visual observation, what are the things that you can identify? You can identify the shape, size, color, surface characteristics, texture of herbal material, fracture characteristics, and appearance of your cut surface, order, and in some cases for some herbal materials, they'll be asking for the taste of the herbal material. Until and unless specified the taste of the herbal material, you are not going to test the taste of your herbal material. If it is specified, you are going to test it. Otherwise, you are not going to test the taste of the herbal material. However, since these characteristics are judged subjectively and substitutes or adulterants may closely resemble the genuine material. So always the visual observation is not, it will not give a genuine result because some adulterants also having the same sort of resemblance in characteristics and properties like your main herbal material. So it is often necessary to substantiate the findings by microscopy and or physicochemical analysis. It is always not to rely upon the macroscopic examinations. Definitely you need to go for microscopic or physicochemical analysis. So coming to the microscopic examination. Coming to the microscopic examination. Once the material has been examined and classified according to external characteristics, okay, that is nothing but through macroscopic inspection. Inspection by microscopic can carried out as the next step. Okay, after completion of macroscopic, after just classifying according to their external characteristic, next step we will move on to microscopy. So, what steps will be involved in microscopy? First one, preliminary treatment. Preliminary treatment of your herbal material with some chemicals. And after that, preparation of specimens. You need to prepare the specimens of that particular herbal material after preliminary treatment. Next, classification of microscopic particles. Classification of microscopic particles. Any herbal material you take, it will contain minute contents. Okay, it will contain minute contents of starch grains, oils, fats, etc. So that classification of microscopic particles should be done. Then after that, histochemical detection of cell walls and contents. Histochemical detection of cell walls. Okay, that is nothing but histopathological studies. Okay, for the detection of cell walls and the contents. Contents are nothing but again your starch grains, oils and fats. Next, measurement of specimens. Measurement of specimens will be done through microscopy. Okay, that specimens that comes under this category are your leaf stomata. Leaf stomata, study of leaf stomata. So under that you are going to study what are the types of stomatas, what are the types of stomata and stomatal index determination, stomatal index determination. Next assessment is thin layer chromatography. Next assessment is thin layer chromatography. Thin layer chromatography is particularly valuable for the qualitative determination of small amount of impurities. What is the purpose of thin layer chromatography? It helps in qualitative determination of small amounts of impurities. Okay, it helps in the determination of small amount of impurities. The following parameters should be determined on the basis of published pharmacopeial monographs or established experimentally for the analysis of each individual herbal material. What are the parameters that should be followed for determination of small amount of impurities by thin layer chromatography. These particular parameters have been published in individual pharmacopeial monographs of each herbal material. Okay, so on a consolidated, what are the parameters to be considered? So the first one, type of absorbent and method of activation. Type of absorbent selected for thin layer chromatography and method of activation should be identified. If no information on the latter can be obtained, heat at 110 degree centigrade for 30 minutes. If there is no method of activation given for so and so herbal material, so ultimately you can just go with heating at 110 degrees for 30 minutes. Next, method of preparation and concentration of the test and reference solution. Next step, method of preparation and concentration of test and reference solution. This particular section will talk about how to prepare test solution, how to prepare reference solution, and what is the concentration to be maintained for test and reference solution. And for all this, what is the procedure given for preparing test and reference solution. Next, volume of the solution to be applied on the plate. How much volume of solution to be applied on the plate? That is the next step. After that, mobile phase and the distance of migration. Information on mobile phase and distance of migration. Next, drying conditions, including temperature and method of detection. Drying conditions and method of detection. And for the spots obtained, number and approximate position, or the R value if necessary, and fluorescence and color. So after doing all these things, after preparation of type of absorbent, after method of activation, then you will go for method of preparation, and you're going to prepare test and reference solutions according to their concentration. Okay, and after that you are going to apply small amount of volume onto the chromatographic plate. And after that, what is the distance of your mobile phase moves and distance of migration. After the drying conditions and method of detection. And after that, for the spots obtained, okay, so you are going to determine that or R value if necessary, and you are going to rely upon your fluorescence and color. Okay, so this is the about the steps involved in thin layer chromatography. Okay, next, two thin layer chromatography methods are described. Two thin layer chromatography methods are described. One is classical method, the other one is micro method. One is classical method, the other one is micro method. Okay, these two methods uses different sizes of plates and hence different quantities of solvents are consumed. These two different methods will have different sizes of plates and hence different quantities of solvents will be used. That's all about today's session. Thank you. Next session will be in continuation with today's session. We'll be discussing about remaining assessments of herbal materials. Thank you.